Gonzalez.
And welcome to all of our listeners and viewers around the country and around the world. We begin today's show on Iraq. If you happen to have tuned into the NBC Nightly News on Wednesday night, you might have been led to believe the Iraq war was all but over. NBC News anchor Brian Williams led the evening's broadcast with an exclusive story on the war.
Our chief foreign correspondent, Richard Engel, who's covered this war for so many years for us, with us from a moving convoy in the Iraqi desert tonight. And Richard, I understand your reporting of this at this hour tonight constitutes the official Pentagon announcement, correct?
Yes, it is. Right now, we are with the last American combat troops, and they are in the process of leaving this country right now. We are with the 4-2 Stryker Brigade. I'm broadcasting right now live from the top of a Stryker fighting vehicle. There are 440 American troops in this convoy. As soon as they cross the border into Kuwait, and it is not far to the border, just about 30 miles from here, as soon as all these soldiers leave Iraq, Operation Iraqi Freedom, the combat mission in Iraq will be over.
That was NBC's Richard Engel in Iraq near the Kuwaiti border with his exclusive report that NBC described as, quote, the official Pentagon announcement of the withdrawal. Although the withdrawal has been hailed as a major milestone in the Iraq war and an end to combat operations, 50,000 U.S. troops will remain in Iraq after the end of this month to help with training and logistics. In addition, the U.S. is keeping 4,500 special operation forces in Iraq to carry out counterterrorism operations. Tens of thousands of private contractors will also remain in the country. State Department spokesperson P.J. Crowley acknowledged earlier this week that the withdrawal of the combat brigades would lead to a doubling in the number of private contractors employed by the State Department.
Where the military has provided security in the past, we now have to provide that security. This is a case where contractors actually, for what we think is a transitory requirement, this is where contractors actually are fruitful. We're able to ramp up an effort for a temporary period of time and then reduce that effort as the security situation improves.
So you've begun contacting them, DynCorp or Z Security?
Yeah, we have very specific plans to increase our security, because as the military is leaving, this will be expensive.
The State Department will use private contractors to guard the massive U.S. embassy in Baghdad, the largest embassy in the world, as well as U.S. consulates in Basra and Erbil and embassy branch offices in Kirkuk and Mosul. The withdrawal of the U.S. combat brigades also comes at a pivotal moment for Iraq. Elections were held in March, but a new government still hasn't been formed. And Baghdad's still reeling from Monday's suicide bombing outside an army recruitment center that killed at least 60 recruits. It was the deadliest attack in Iraq this year. To talk more about the situation, we're joined by two Iraqis. Ra'ed Jarar is in Washington. He's Iraq consultant for American Friends Service Committee and a senior fellow at Peace Action. Yanar Mohammed is joining us from Toronto. She's president of the Organization of Women's Freedom in Iraq. Ra'ed, let's begin with you. Can you assess what the situation on the ground is right now?
I don't think the what happened this week or what will be happening by the end of this month will have any real implications on the situation on the ground, because most of the U.S. Troops, the combat forces, have left Iraqi cities and towns and villages last June. So there are near no real implications of what is happening now on the situation. The situation in Iraq is extremely bad. It's very bad. The services that the Iraqi public are receiving are dysfunctional. People don't have access to very basic services like water, electricity, sewage, education, and healthcare. The political situation is deteriorating. It's very bad. Iraq does not have a government almost after 6 months of the election. And the security situation is extremely bad as well. So, but these are two different tracks, though. From an Iraqi perspective, although a majority of Iraqis, maybe a national consensus, would agree that the situation is extremely bad in Iraq, that Iraq is still broken, there is still a majority of Iraqis who want this occupation to end. So it's not like Iraqis believe that prolonging the occupation would fix what this occupation has broken.
And Roy Girard, what about this issue of the seeming paralysis of the government and being able to, following elections, months have passed without a clear agreement on who will continue to run the government in Iraq?
There are a number of reasons that have led to this delay. I mean, first of all, the election itself was a very important and positive development in Iraq because the Iraqi public did vote for parties that has more nationalist tendencies, parties that are for ending the occupation, parties that are for ending sectarian divisions and sectarian allocationism in the government. So the election itself was good news. Now, the reasons why the election has taken a long time to form the government, we've been having around, it's been almost 6 months now. There are some external reasons, the fact that some regional governments, including the Iranian government, have been interfering in the process negatively. Some other interventions have been slowing down the process. And there are some domestic reasons, the inability of some Iraqi leaders to put their differences aside and move forward. But the main reason why we have this deadlock now is the fact that Iraq does not have a functional democracy. We cannot expect to have a functional democracy from Iraq that was imposed by a foreign occupation. That is why millions of Iraqis, including myself, said from the beginning this occupation should not have started, should not start from the beginning, because there is no such a thing as implanting a functional democracy from outside. It's a broken system. It has many problems. But although, you know, the situation is very bad, I still have hope that Iraqi political leaders will manage to create a new government within the upcoming weeks.
On this issue, Ra'ed, of Iraq's failure to form a new government after the March election, this is what the Iraqi Prime Minister Nouri al-Maliki said earlier this month.
أنا متأكد إذا يأتي رئيس وزراء ضعيف وإذا يأتي رئيس وزراء غير مدعوم من قبل غالبية القوى السياسية والكتل.
I'm sure that if the next prime minister is weak and not supported by the majority of political blocs, entities, and parliament, the big danger is that it will affect the unity of Iraq and the security situation. Militias and gangs will return, al-Qaeda will return, there will be conflicts. There are many people lurking who are waiting to seize any gap. We need a man who knows the map of existing challenges, diplomatic, external, and internal relations, national unity, national reconciliation, and the unity of Iraq.
That was the Iraqi Prime Minister Nouri al-Maliki earlier this month. Ra'ed, your response?
I think this is a very destructive way of dealing with the situation by Mr. al-Maliki. Choosing the next prime minister is not like hiring a new employee and they're putting, you know, some requirements for the new prime minister. There are existing regulations and constitutional articles that show us how to choose the next prime minister. The prime minister should be chosen in accordance to the election results. Whomever is the head of the largest bloc in the parliament gets to become the prime minister. Unfortunately, many Iraqi politicians, including Mr. al-Maliki, are trying to circumvent the results of the election and try to make it an issue of you know, who to choose based on their qualifications, rather than going back to the election results and abiding by what the Iraqi people have said.
Ra'ed Girard, Iraq consultant for American Friends Service Committee, senior fellow at Peace Action. When we come back, we'll also be joined by Yanar Mohammed.